Sick report. Mother Lucy Johnson, Brother Willie Jones, Greg Brooks, Sister Hazel and family, Sister Dupree and family, Willie Moore and family, J.R. Griffin, Mother Harvey, Sister Ann Harvey, Sister Anderson and Baby Carter, Sister Linda Patterson, Sister Selma Sizer, Kyrie Mosley, Erlene Bradley and family, the Garrett family, Doretha Richmond and family, Mother Elmira Watkins, Sister Betty Russell, Mr. Melvin and Mrs. Bunny Hodge, Mr. and Mrs. Hughes, Brother Willie McClendon, Mother Lily Lacey, Sister Mary Berry, Devin Watson, the Crooks family, Marshall Brown and family, Tawanda Mixon Burnett, Felicia Smith, Williams family, the Turner family, Deacon Bradley and family, and Brother Chris McPherson. This is our announcements and sick report. We want to welcome all our visitors. Services are Sunday school every Sunday at 8:15. Worship services every Sunday at 9:15, and Bible study is every Wednesday at 5 p.m. Thank you.
Amen, church.
Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to ask that you stand for the song of the hour. If you haven't already prayed for the pastor, please whisper a prayer that God will speak through me on this morning. I know one thing, I'm serious about this Christian journey that I'm on. Went to a funeral yesterday. Preacher passed away. And I realized that one day, where he laid, I'll be laying. And I want to make heaven my home. So every day of my life, I'm living for the Lord. You turn it up just a little bit. Said it's the love of money. that's the root of all evil. St. Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. And I think I ought to tell you before we read these scriptures that when God allows me to come to Radnip, and when God sends me here every Sunday morning, when you leave, if you leave here not knowing that you need the Lord, I've not done my job.
All right.
So it's important to me that when you leave, that you know that you can't make it out here by yourself.
Yes, sir.
That you need the Lord.
Yes, sir.
Amen. St. Luke chapter 10, verse 38. When you find it, I'm certain you'll find these words recorded. Now it came to pass, as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister have left me to serve alone? Bid her, therefore, that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful. But one thing is needful. And Mary had chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. I'd like to offer for a subject taken from these passages and other supporting passages of Scripture. I came for the good part. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I came for the good part. Jesus said, but one thing is needful, and Mary has chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. And church, I want you to know that I came for the good part.
Yes, sir.
You know, some folk go to school all the way to 12th grade and then go to college, but they really don't learn anything. They just go through the motion just to get a piece of paper, but they hadn't learned anything. Did you know that some folk go to football games, but they can't tell you nothing about the game because they were outside tailgating, cooking, and weren't even watching the game? Yeah, some folk, some church folk, I might always say, not Christian, but some church folk, they won't be able to tell you what today's sermon was about because they ain't come to church for that. They came to see what they can find wrong about the service. I'm talking about church folk. I ain't talking about Christians now. Yeah. They came to see what you were wearing and to show you what they had on. I'm talking about church folk. Not Christian. Yeah, that's what church folk do. They take notes about about what's going on in the church so they can give a report back to their posse, to their partners. They don't take notes about the sermon. I'm talking about church folk now. Christians really take notes about the sermon and so that they can live a better life. But church folk, they taking notes all right, but it ain't to help them or you. In other words, everybody don't come to church for the good part. But if I were you, I wouldn't let nothing or nobody stop me from receiving the good part. You know, if you find yourself sitting beside somebody and they see you trying to tune in and trying to stay focused on the word of God, but they constantly want to talk to you about stuff that ain't even pertaining to church. If I were you, I'd just politely move so that they don't stop me from receiving the good part. Now, that's exactly what was going on in our text this morning. Our text this morning involves two sisters that live in the same house. Mary and Martha were their names. And listen, Mary and Martha experience teaches us that waiting and sitting at the feet of Jesus is more important than running here and there to and fro, trying to do a lot of work, trying to find favor in God. It's more important that you find somewhere and sit still and listen to the word of God. It's more profitable for you. And church, God has charged me this morning to inform you that no matter how busy you are in the church, no matter how busy you are for the church, and no matter how much you're responsible for outside the church, there is one basic essential in life that's important, and that is sitting at the feet of Jesus to hear his holy and divine word. Yeah, that's the basic essential for our life. Now, before I talk too much about Mary and Martha this morning, let's look at what's happening in this day and time. Yeah, Mary and Martha was in the Bible day, right? Well, let's look at what's happening in this day and time. And I think I ought to tell you, this sermon is not just for Radley Chapel, but God's word applies to everyone and everywhere. The point is that most churches have Bible class through the week. Is that right?
That's right.
That's right. Okay. All right. And most churches have Sunday school on Sunday morning. Right? Okay. All right. And then most churches have worship service after Sunday school every Sunday morning, right?
Yeah.
All right. So all of these services, I'm talking about this day and time. I ain't talking about Mary and Martha just yet. So all these churches offer these services, not just to certain people.
That's right.
But Bible class is open to everybody, right? Sunday school is open to everybody, right? Worship service, the doors are open to everybody. But everybody won't come. I'm talking about this day and time. Everybody won't come. And listen, I hear excuses all the time. I hear excuses like, that's too early for me to get up. But in the morning, you're going to be up a whole lot earlier getting ready to go to work if you got a job. Yeah, I hear excuses like, I can't get my children up and dressed in time for Sunday school. But I noticed something. They on time at the bus stop, and they certainly on time for school every morning. I hear excuses like, I work so hard through the week, I got to get my rest on Sundays. But I noticed something. Preachers, I noticed something. That you say you got to get your rest on Sundays, but on Saturdays, you up early washing the car. You out shopping on Saturdays. You watching the games on Saturday. Why don't you get your rest on Saturday instead of putting God on the back burner on Sunday? My Lord. Preached every Sunday a sweet message that made you happy, he ain't doing what he's supposed to do. And I know I ain't making some folk happy right now, but I gotta preach this gospel whether you want to hear it or whether you don't want to hear it. I gotta preach it in season and out of season. Now I think I ought to tell you, God don't accept no excuses when you put other things before him. Listen, church. We all have the same opportunity to grow in Christ. And how do we grow? Deacon Harvey this morning, he was pleading with the Sunday school. He said, we need to please ask people to come to Bible class. We need to please ask people to come to Sunday school and to worship service. He said, what we're teaching is good, and the people need to be out to hear. Everybody have the same opportunity to come to Bible class. Some people thought that it was too late when we had it at 6. So now we have it at 5. I think I ought to tell you that it's a sacrifice for everybody. It's a sacrifice for everybody. My wife has to get up every Sunday morning, way ahead of time, to get Mama ready to come to church. Wednesdays, we got to get her ready. Y'all got children. And if you want them to go to school and be there on time, what you going to do? You going to get up. It's just going to depend on where your priority is. You can do whatever you want to do if your heart is in it. But it's up to each individual to choose to complain, make excuses, or you can choose the good part, which is taking advantage of every opportunity you get to sit at the feet of Jesus and receive the Word of God. You got options here. You can choose after this sermon today. You can be mad and you can say, I didn't like that sermon. Uh-huh. Or you can say, the pastor right, I'm going to do better. Because I want the good part that Christ has to offer.
Glory. Glory. Thank you, Lord.
Now, I'm not Jesus by any means. Neither was Peter. But just like he said to Peter, he has said to me that I give you the keys to the kingdom. God has given me the keys to the kingdom, which is the word of God. And that's the good part that every one of us need. We need the word of God. Now in our text this morning, I know somebody said, I'm glad you're finna get off us and get on Mary and Martha. Minister say, rewind. Praise the Lord. Now, in our text, church, both of these sisters had some great characteristics about themselves. Both of them had some good things going on in their life. Yeah, both of them were good people. But I want to deal with Martha first. When we look at verse number 38, it says, now it came to pass as they went, meaning they, that's Jesus and his disciples, as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. The house belonged to Martha. Yeah. But she owned the house, but her sister Mary and her brother Lazarus lived with her. Martha was the first person seen. She had a highly commendable character. She should be commended. Martha should really be commended. She was a good person. And Jesus loved her. The word says in John chapter 11, verse 5, that Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. He loved that family. So everything that Jesus did in our text today concerning Martha, I want y'all to know it was done strictly out of love. And every time that I stand behind this sacred desk and preach, even though I step on some toes, I want y'all to know it's done out of love. My Lord. I don't come here, nor do I go to any church when I'm invited to preach for money. In fact, there have been some churches where I got in my car and to leave, And the pastor had to chase me down and say, did they take care of you? I said, what you mean? He said, did they pay you? I said, don't worry about that, pastor. I don't preach for money. I preach because I love God's people. And I want to see us all make it to heaven. God supplies my needs. Whatever we need in the Lacey household, God supplies our need for us. And he's proven that he's the one that's taking care of us. My Lord. Martha had a lot of strong points in her life. But my question is this, church. What causes a strong person to fail? So she had a lot of strong points in her life, but she was about to become a failure. And the answer is this. Most strong people have strong bodies, but they got a weak mind. My Lord. They got a strong body where they can work their fingers to the bone. They can do a whole lot of stuff. They can work from can to can, from sun up to sundown. But they got a weak mind. A lot of strong people make all the money in a week and can spend it all in one night. They got a weak mind. I know the Lord is all right. But they don't know how to sit at the feet of Jesus to be fed the word of God. They're too busy. The word of God, I keep telling you, that's the good part. Now, I can remember the Israelites. They wanted a king. And they already had God. They already had the good part. But they wanted what other folks had. And I'm sorry, Randy, that I don't sing like a lot of preachers sing. But I'm going to tell you this. I got the good part because God gave it to me. And ain't nothing wrong with singing. I like to hear preachers sing. I like that. But when you get through singing, you make sure you give your people a word that's going to keep them. Martha was a very good person. She was so generous with her giving. She owned a big house. The house that Martha owned, it was so large that she could prepare rooms for Jesus and his disciples when they came into town. She always spent money to entertain them when they stopped by. Martha had some good characteristics about herself. And Martha was a brave lady. She was brave and she was very courageous. You see, at this particular time, it was dangerous to associate yourself with Jesus because the authorities, they had put a hit out on Jesus. They was trying to find ways to kill him. And it wasn't smart for anybody to be associated with Jesus during this time. But Martha didn't care. She didn't care what the world thought. She was willing to let everybody know that she was devoted to Jesus Christ. And when Jesus came to town, she knew that the people knew he was coming inside of her house. But she wasn't afraid. She welcomed Jesus inside of her home. But this time, when Jesus stopped by, Martha got a little salty with her sister Mary. I want to talk about Mary's characteristics for a minute now. Mary, on the other hand, she also needs to be commended because Mary, too, was a good person. But when you look at verse number 39, it says, and she, meaning Martha, had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. Mary was a loving and very humble person. Mary loved Jesus. She loved him so much that she would attach herself to Jesus every time he showed up. Her love and devotion ran deep. It ran so deep that nothing else mattered except being right next to Jesus every chance she got. That's somebody that loved the Lord, isn't that right? Anybody here love being attached to Jesus? I love being attached to the Lord. it's good to attach yourself to the Lord, and that way, wherever you go, the Lord is right there with you. And if we attach ourselves to the Lord, I promise you, you'll make a lot better decisions in life, every day of your life. Good God Almighty. Notice this, church. Mary sat at his feet. She didn't sit by his side. She didn't sit way out in front of him. She sat at his feet. And you know the room was large enough to entertain a large crowd, so she could have sat anywhere. But she chose. And it's about choices. You got to choose to get close to the Lord. And she chose to sit at the feet of Jesus. She chose the good part, I tell you. Yeah, Mary had a devoted love and a humble spirit about herself. She wanted to be blessed. Mary had a spiritual hunger for the word of God. And you know, and I see some of the members, I see y'all sometimes making notes. And when I see you making notes, I know that you're trying to live a better life. You making notes because you want to have something to feed and feast upon, not only on Sunday morning, but through the week. That's what a good Christian will do. I know the Lord is all right. Yeah, Mary sat there. And Mary fixed her eyes on Jesus. Mary centered her mind on everything that Jesus was saying. She blocked out everything else going on in the world. She was focused on the word of God. And that's how we ought to be when we come to church. We ought to block out everything. I know some basketball games coming on today, but you ought not be thinking about them in church. I know that you got to eat when you get home, but you ought not be thinking about what you're going to cook. You ought to be focused on the word of God, on the good part. Mary took the word of God to heart. She wanted to be saved. But Martha just couldn't handle how calm Mary was. I really wish y'all could have been there. Martha couldn't handle it. Martha felt like, she felt like, you living in my house, eating my food. Yeah. But you ain't doing nothing to help me get ready for the master. I'm doing all this work by myself, and you sitting over there all calm and cool. And I'm moving and running, trying to do stuff in this house. Martha had an attitude, to say the least. When you look at verse number 40, it says this, but Martha was cumbered about much serving. She and listen, y'all, she didn't go to her sister. She went to Jesus. Why did she go to Jesus instead of going to Mary? If you got a problem with Mary, why didn't you go to Mary? She went to Jesus because she wanted Jesus to recognize her hard work. She wanted Jesus to see all the work she was doing in the church, in the house. She went to Jesus and she said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister have left me alone to serve y'all by myself? That's right, sister. That's right. No, he wasn't. But she wanted to point it out to Jesus, everything that she was doing. He saw what she was doing. He see everything that we do. But if you're doing it for the wrong reason, you're not helping yourself, and you sure ain't helping the Lord. With my spiritual ear, I can hear Martha telling Jesus, I know you see me running and turning and twisting around here. I know you see me cooking and serving y'all. I can hear Martha telling Jesus these things. Then, church, I want you to look at what Martha did. She didn't ask Jesus. She told him, bid her that she help me. In other words, tell my sister to get up from sitting by your feet and help me cook and feed y'all. Help me clean this big house. She's sitting over there looking pretty while I'm going crazy. She had a bad attitude against her own sister. When we look at verse number 41, Jesus had to stop teaching the word of God to respond to Martha. He had to stop teaching so he could respond to Martha, because Martha was not going to let it go. She was running. She had plates in her hand. She was running. Y'all need some more wine? She was running. What else you need? She was just running. And Mary was just sitting at the feet of Jesus, getting the good part. Ain't the Lord all right? So when we look at 41, we know that Jesus was not happy with Martha, y'all. He wasn't happy with Martha at all. But listen, he understood her complaint. He wasn't happy with it, but he understood her complaint. Yeah, and church, let me tell you something. It's okay to keep it real with Jesus. It's okay to keep it real with the Lord. But whatever you gotta say to the Lord, make sure you say it respectfully when you talk to the Lord. If you disagree with something that's going on, it's okay to voice that to the Lord, but make sure you do it in a respectful manner. And Martha was respectful. She was okay, but she had a complaint. Sometimes we don't really know how to talk to the Lord, and sometimes we talk to the Lord out of frustration. Yeah, sometimes. Anybody ever talk to God and you frustrated with him? Oh, let me ask it again. Maybe y'all don't never get upset with the Lord. Maybe I'm the only one that get upset with the Lord sometimes. Sometimes we get angry with God because you won't make my wife come to church with me. Sometimes we get angry with God because you won't make my husband get his life together. And before we know it, we being like Martha. And instead of just talking to God, we trying to give God orders. We trying to tell God what to do. Don't you know that your own family, your own husband, your own wife, your own children, don't you know that they will issue a formal complaint against you to God? Anybody here glad that we serve an understanding God? Because if he was not understanding, when you talk to God and try to tell him what to do, if he was not a good God, he'll put a curse on you. And he'll cut you short right then. But we serve an understanding God. So instead of him getting upset with Martha, this is what he did. He responded in a very loving and kind way to Martha. And God corrects us. Whenever we get out of line, he corrects us in a loving kind of way. Yes, sir. Now watch this. Watch this, church. The problems in your life and the problems in my life ain't always the other person. Oh, Lord. The problems in your life and the problems in my life ain't always the other person's fault. And just maybe, when you get mad with that wife that won't come to church with you, just maybe you ought to try having church with her at home first. Maybe you ought to just try a little tenderness at home. Maybe you ought to treat her like the queen that she really is at home first. And I believe that if you did that, she'll follow you to the moon and back. Just maybe when you want that husband to get his life together. Just maybe. Yeah. If you go back to the wife that you were when he first married you. Maybe if you go back to showing that kind of love and respect to him when he first married you, just maybe, he'll get his life together. Maybe when you first married him, he didn't even know you could curse. But now, you'll cuss him out in a minute. But you want him to get his life together. To him. He got a way to correct us. And listen, you see, church, the problem was not Mary. The problem was really Martha. She was her own problem. So this is what I know. Anytime I have a problem in my home or in my life, I've learned before I go to God about it, I learn how to walk in my bathroom and I learn how to look at the man in the mirror. Because a lot of times the problem that I have, I'm the fault. It ain't my wife. We men love to blame stuff on the wives. But a lot of times the problem is the man or the woman that's in the mirror. And God had to show Martha that Mary was not the problem. Ain't the Lord all right? So when we look at verse number 41, Jesus, look how Jesus handled this situation. He spoke very calmly and very softly. He said, Martha, Martha, can't y'all hear me? Martha, Martha, you careful and you trouble about so many things. I can hear him saying, I never told you to do anything to try to impress me, Martha. Martha, I never asked you to serve me and the disciples nothing. We fine. We go out there and we can make figs appear on a tree if we hungry. We can go out there and we can touch a rock and we can get water. Martha, you ain't got to be running around doing all this stuff trying to impress me. He said, I came to your home to share the word of God with you, not to be entertained. I could hear him telling Martha, I have what you need. You don't have what I need. Jesus said, you twisting around here, Martha. You worried. You full of anxiety. You distracted. You're trying to serve this person and that person. He said, you cumbered, which means you loaded down with the cares and needs of other folks.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You put yourself under a lot of unnecessary pressure and stress.
Yes, sir.
Somebody here
yes,
is putting yourself under a whole lot of unnecessary
yes,
pressure
yes,
and stress. You're doing it to yourself.
Yes, sir.
It's not a requirement of the Lord.
Okay.
My Lord. You got to learn how to choose the good part in life. I tell my wife all the time. She might get upset, it might be fussing, and I might just keep on walking like on here. And I say, don't sweat the little stuff. That's some bigger problem that might come up in our life that might give you a reason to get so upset. And she calms all the way down. When you talk to them like that.
Uh-huh.
And the same thing happens to us as well. We get upset sometimes over little stuff. We let other stuff weigh us down. And can I help somebody? Stop going home fussing and fighting with your spouse over other folk. Y'all in a discussion about somebody else, and y'all about to fall out with each other. They don't even involve y'all. Jesus said, you lose sight, Martha, of the real priority. He said, you become aggravated and you become critical of other folks, all because they won't help you. You feel like in your house, you feel like you got to cook, you got to clean, you got to iron, you got to do everything. And the other person in there reading the Bible. He getting the good part. But you mad because they ain't helping you clean up the house. My Lord. I want the good part, church. I want the house clean too. I want the yard cut too. But I ain't gonna be like some folks cut the yard 3 times a week. I don't want the same thing to happen to you that happened to Martha. You do know that it was the things of this world that distracted Martha from Jesus, don't you? It was the things of this world. It was like food, necessities, cares, social entertainment. And I know we need all of those things at times, but don't let those things choke you and cause you to lose track of the main mission, and that's Jesus Christ. The grass withers. The flowers fade. But the word of God will stand forever. That's the good part. Jesus really had compassion on Martha. He knew she was disturbed with him and with her sister. But church, the difference in Mary and Martha is this. Martha only caught bits and pieces of the sermon. That's all Martha could catch because she wasn't focused. She was too busy. She never sat still long enough to get the full word of God.
Glory, glory.
But Mary received everything that Christ had to give. She chose the good part. So I ask you this morning, which one are you? Are you Mary, who know how to sit still and how to receive the word of God? Or are you Martha, that's just busy all the time and never take time to hear from heaven? If you're Martha, today I want you to change and become Mary. I want you to receive the good part. As I head toward a close, I want the church to always remember this. Jesus never get excited about stuff and things. He was poor in worldly goods. He didn't have no house. He didn't have no car. He didn't even have a place to call home. He didn't have a place to lay his head. That stuff didn't impress him. He didn't have a big bank account. Sometimes he didn't even have money to buy food. Didn't even have money to pay tithe. He had to tell one of the disciples to go out there and when the fish opened his mouth, get the money out the fish mouth. He didn't worry about that kind of stuff. He always stressed to us to put our spiritual needs above our physical needs. So in this last verse, Jesus said to Martha, and I'm paraphrasing now, I see you have a nice big house. I see you have good food and wine. I see how busy you are around here. And I see you running here and there. I see that you're involved with a lot of things. But he told her, you're wasting your time. Because only one thing is needful. And Mary has chosen the good part. Saints, can I tell you, only what you do for Christ will last, and the Lord, all right. I can hear Jesus saying to Martha, when I leave here, your house is going to get nasty again, and your food is soon going to run out. I can hear him saying, you're going to get distracted all over again. But Mary, she chose the good part. Ain't the Lord all right? Mary chose, she chose joy and peace of mind. Mary chose to sit at the feet of Jesus. Jesus and be blessed. Ain't he all right? Mary chose love and Mary chose life and to have life more abundantly. Ain't the Lord all right? I can hear Jesus saying, and no matter what tomorrow might bring, that love that Mary chose, that joy that Mary chose, the world didn't give it to her, and the world can't take it away. Do I have a witness this morning? The world might take away the house I live in. The world might take away my land. But all I know, I still got Jesus. As long as I got Jesus, that's all I need. Do I have a witness this morning? I don't know about you boys, but I'm glad, y'all, that I chose the good part. Anybody here glad that you chose the good part? Christ, he means more to me than anything that this world could ever offer me. Anybody here got a made up mind? Anybody here, are you holding on to God's unchanging hand? Anybody here know he died for us? Anybody know he died, y'all? He died one Friday, but the good part is early the third day morning. He got up with all power in his hand, and that's the good part. And I don't know about you, boy, but I'm holding on to God's unchanging hand. I chose the good part. Anybody here chose the good part? Anybody chose Jesus? I decided to make Jesus my choice. The doors of the church is open. The doors of the church is open. Will there be one? Might not know the Lord and the pardon of your sins. Today is your day. You ought to give your life to Jesus. He gave his life for you and I. He died way out on that old rugged cross. But the good part is he rose. You may come by land of baptism or by Christian experience. Hold on. We got to hold on to God's unchanging hand, I tell you.
Won't ever turn his back on you.
Yeah, I'm holding on, I tell you.
God's unchanging hand.
misunderstood, but I'm still holding on.
Eternal Father in heaven, we come now. Lord,
you said I would see.
Yes.
But Lord, you gave me the courage to preach your word.
Yes.
And for that I say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
And Lord, I'm asking that you would touch the hearts of your people that are here today. And the ones that will hear and see this message online. I'm asking that if we have Marthas out there that are too busy for you, I'm asking that you would teach them how to become Marys that would learn how to sit at your feet and be blessed. Lord, I believe your word has fallen on good soil today. And for that I say thank you. As we get ready to leave this place but never your presence, we ask for traveling grace. Help us to make it back home into our destination and find everything all right. Lord, I pray that you will use Minister Evans on today to preach your word. Lord, we love you so much. We do lift you up. We will forever magnify your holy name. Now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us all, now, henceforth, and forever. Let us all say amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. We love you so much. Go in.